We are right at the very beginning. Has anyone here read 1 John? Any of it? A little bit of it? Some. Great. No prior knowledge, no prerequisites necessary for this course. So you've done very well. It's not a course. It's going to be really exciting. I think it's going to be actually really fantastic for each of us as we look to these next 13 weeks to see what God might have to say to us from John. John is a different kind of guy. He's a guy who is very exuberant. Jesus called him and his brother the sons of thunder. He's like, you guys are little balls of energy. John traveled with Jesus for 3 years of Jesus' life and ministry on earth. And then John lived for a long time after Jesus went to be with the Father. And John really had a very unique perspective on the life and work of Jesus, especially because over his lifetime, all of the other disciples, well, the original apostles, all of them were killed. All of them were either brutally murdered or slaughtered somehow for proclaiming Jesus, for standing up for Jesus, for telling people about God's love. Can you imagine people coming and saying, God loves you so much that despite our own rebellion against him, God would send his son Jesus to die for us, and those people would turn around and say, well, I don't like that, so we're going to murder you. Beheadings, hangings, crucifixion, a whole bunch of different stuff. John watched or heard about all of those people, all of his original co-laborers, people that he would have considered friends and family, die along the way. And here he is later in life, generations of Christians later, telling people still about the love of Jesus. They tried to kill John as well. Church history tells us they put him in a pot and tried to boil him alive. And when that didn't kill him, they exiled him to a rocky island called Patmos, where he lived for a number of years. So he has walked with Jesus. He's suffered for Jesus. And as we read his letter, in fact, he wrote a bunch of letters. He wrote the Gospel of John. He wrote, or at least transcribed, the book of Revelation as well, the Revelation of John. He wrote a big chunk of scripture. You never hear him in any of this complaining about his life. Never hear him complaining about the difficulties that he's gone through because of Jesus. What you hear him saying over and over and over again in this letter is God is light. God is love. God is for you. 40 times he mentions either God's love for you, the love that we should and can have for each other. This is a letter of love. And it's a letter that you hear, if you would read it, it's not very long, it's 5 chapters long. Obviously, if you were going to write a letter to somebody else, you wouldn't anticipate that they would partition it off into chapters and verses and just read like 4 verses at the beginning and then not read anything for a week, come back and read the next 5 verses. You'd expect it to be read as a letter. And if you read it all in one go, it might take you 15 minutes if you're an average reader. If you're a really slow reader, maybe 25 minutes. So the average length of a short comedy show, just flip off Netflix and crack open the Bible. You will hear, you will read. Not only does John want to convey the love of Jesus to his readers, to his audience, you can hear his own love. He's an old dude, and you can hear he writes things like, "My little children." He's got this fatherly heart, like God has a father heart for him and for us. He is likewise carrying this heart like a father for his people. They're going through difficult times. There's been significant persecution. Like I said, John has seen all of his friends die. All of them die. And he's seen people coming into the church and they are preaching things other than Jesus. Or they're starting to preach things using the name of Jesus, but they're meaning a completely different thing. And John is writing to them like a father writing to his children, saying, "My children, my dear children who I love, we need to have a chat about some things." John, if you read through John's gospel, you'll hear in John's gospel, John and Jesus were like best buddies. Do you have a best mate, or have you ever had a best friend? Had someone who you know, this person, they've got your back. You've been through some stuff with this person. If you want some embarrassing stories about somebody, you go ask their parents, go ask their mum. The mum will have the embarrassing stories. You want to know where the bodies are buried? You go ask someone's best friend. You want to know like their deepest, darkest secrets and fears? Most likely, you won't ask the parents. You ask the best mate. They're the ones who have been, for adults at least, they're the ones who have been through some serious stuff together. They're the ones who you'll open up to about some stuff. And when Jesus was hanging on the cross, there with him, others had scattered. Other disciples had really, they'd gone into hiding. But there's John, his like best mate and little brother, really. Not biological, but like a little brother to him. In fact, to the point where he looks down to John and he says, John, this is my mum, Mary, and she's now your mum, and Mary, this is now your son. Saying, John, I trust you like a brother to look after my mum. Now that I'm going. That's some deep love and trust. And this is the John who's writing to us. There, like I said before, there have been a couple of probably generations of Christians that have grown up with Christian parents, had kids, and their kids are growing up again, with Christian parents in this time. And John, as a super old guy, is now writing this message because there are being some people who have come in and started to spread some false ideas about who Jesus is. And one of the reasons I think this letter is so important for us today is that there are lots and lots of Christians who have grown up in not even post-persecution era, but geographically, we do not suffer for our faith like our brothers and sisters do in other parts of the world, and certainly in other times throughout history. And so because there is no refinement through persecution, through struggles, unless we ourselves stand up for our faith, Christian life can become pretty easy, to the point where we hear the things of the gospel and the love of God, and it starts to really just bounce off us. Like, oh yeah, we know that. I've heard this stuff since I was a kid. There were some of you here who you did grow up in a Christian home, and you've traveled really well, never really having a time away from God or any kind of rebellion. There were some of you here who will have maybe grown up in a Christian home, but had a substantial amount of time where you just thought, that's just not for me. I hear these things. I get what you're saying, but that's just there's no real like impact in who I am. There were some of you who you didn't have Christian home, you didn't grow up in and around a Christian family, and so some of these things are, or have been at least at one stage, really new and striking to you. We've gone, can that be really true? That despite my sin, God loves me enough to send his own son to die for me, to show his glory and for my own salvation. Could that be true? And there'll be some of you who became a Christian like that, but it's been a number of years. And we get to this point, I think like the readers of John's letter here, where we come to a place where everything seems pretty good. Everything seems pretty dandy. There's not a whole lot of struggle and strife going on anymore. And then somebody else comes in and says, oh, you think that Jesus is like that? No, no, no. Jesus is more like this. Or, oh, you think that scripture tells us what Jesus is like? Well, I couldn't believe in a Jesus who was like this. I couldn't believe in a God who was like this. And this is exactly what was happening in John's time. There were people coming into the church and saying, you believe that Jesus rose from the dead physically? That sounds ridiculous. No, 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 no. He didn't do that. And they were leading people astray. Or they were causing people who weren't led astray to begin to doubt themselves and doubt what they'd heard and doubt the things that they had even seen. And so this letter in part is a written response to these false teachers. And John, man, like I said, he's a bold guy. He's brash at some stage, some points. This is how he refers to these false teachers, these people saying things about Jesus that aren't true, just in this letter. And remember, this is called the letter of love. This is how he speaks about people who are trying to tell incorrect things about Jesus. He calls them antichrists. Ouch. He calls them liars, deceivers, lawless, children of the devil. One of my favorites. Can you imagine calling someone, you child of Satan? That's a rough thing to say. Like, if you mean it like John means it, whew, you offspring of the devil. Yikes. Like Cain. Cain, like Cain and Abel, who murdered his brother. He's calling them murderers. Those of the world, false prophets, the spirit of the Antichrist, spirit of error, and in the power of the evil one. This is the letter of love, and this is how seriously John takes how we view Jesus. Sometimes we think of like doctrine or theology as some like stodgy old person with like a monocle and a bow tie in a dusty mahogany and leather clad office with old school books with big words. And we go, well, that's Jesus is just about love, right? So we'll just leave that whole thing over there. And we're just all going to be about love. And John says, actually, it's important. If you're going to claim to be all about love and all about Jesus, you've got to know who Jesus is. And we do that by having correct and sound theology, correct doctrine. All that means is, do you believe that Jesus is who Jesus says he is? That's what it means to have sound doctrine. That's what it means. And he's revealed himself. We believe he's revealed himself through his scripture, through the Bible. And this is part of what John is writing here. You might have heard even preachers preach from John 10, again, from John's writing. The thief comes to steal and kill and destroy. And almost invariably, I mean, every time I've heard that preached, the preacher says, and, you know, that's all about Satan wanting to come and take things from you or kill or destroy. No, Jesus isn't talking about Satan in John 10. He's talking about false teachers want to come in to the flock and steal your freedom. They want to come in and steal and thief from you your joy. They want to murder your faith and your assurance in your salvation. That's Jesus talking. And John, like Jesus' best mate, little brother, hey, little bud, how you doing? He grows up as well, walking with Jesus, filled with the Holy Spirit. He says the same thing in this letter. He says, it's so important that we know who Jesus is. We don't just have some sort of vague idea of our opinion of love and project that, read that into Scripture, that we actually know who Jesus is. John actually says, I have, throughout his letter, he gives four reasons, four purposes for writing this letter. Firstly, we'll look at this tonight in our passage, joy. He says, this is why I'm writing, joy. This is why I'm writing, for holiness, that you would pursue holiness and know what that is. In 1 John 2, he says, this is why I'm writing, that you would have correct doctrine. And later in chapter 5, he says, this is why I'm writing, that you would have an assurance of your salvation, that you would know who Jesus is, and know that no thief, no false teacher can come and separate you from the love of God. Nobody can come and steal or rob your salvation from you if you know the Jesus of the Bible. John wrote this letter primarily to show how people can know that they are really Christians. John Stott, he said it like this: there's a true Christian assurance, which is neither arrogant nor presumptuous, but is on the contrary, as this letter will show, the plainly revealed word of God for his people. So John urges his readers to examine themselves, and he supplies tests by which they and we may do so. So we've called this whole series Proof of Life. You might have seen a movie where it's usually the daughter of some really rich couple or powerful politician is kidnapped, and the negotiator or the parents are on the phone with the kidnapper, and they say, if you want these millions of dollars, we're going to need some proof of life. We need to know, we need some assurance that there is life that we're dealing with here. And then, you know, they'll either talk to them on the phone or they'll get a finger with a wedding ring in the mail or something equally gross like that as proof of life. And we don't want to get gross like that. Sorry for disturbing you down the back. But what we want to do is examine ourselves. John actually gives us some tests that we can actually match up our life, match up our doctrine, match up our thinking next to Scripture and have an assurance of our salvation. Not because we are earning it with our works or with our life or with our doctrine. Not because, oh good, I can tick all these boxes, therefore God has to love me. But because God has already loved you. God has already acted upon his love towards you by sending his son Jesus to divert his just wrath from us who deserved it onto Jesus. That he would become, like John writes in this letter, the propitiation for our sins. Which means, again, he absorbs the wrath of a just God on himself. Bears our penalty and then imputes to us his own righteousness. Gifts us his own righteousness. Because of this, when Jesus' righteousness is applied to you, when the Holy Spirit is living in you, which is the guarantee, which is the assurance of our salvation, then we naturally will have these outworkings in our life that John goes into. These three tests in 1 John, by which we may judge whether we possess eternal life or not. The first is theological. Do we have a correct opinion or idea about who Jesus is? Do we know Jesus? Do we believe that he is the Son of God? Do we believe that he came in the flesh? No system of teaching, John Stott says, which denies either the eternal divine pre-existence of Jesus or the historical incarnation of Jesus, that he came for us, became flesh, can be accepted as Christian. So no matter how nice or well-meaning or well-spoken people might be, if they deny the fundamental truths of who Jesus is, they are not from Jesus. This is one of the reasons that we're so big on the Word. It's one of the reasons that we are going through pretty much line by line this book of the Bible and books of the Bible in general as we go through our series in books of the Bible, because we're not trying to divine or understand things from our worldly or human wisdom, from our best perspective. We can only just glimpse a small amount of the glory of God, but he's revealed himself through Scripture in the person and work of Jesus. And so what we want to do is read through Scripture, expound upon Scripture, use Scripture as our highest earthly authority, and trust that the Holy Spirit is speaking and ministering to our hearts as we do so. Because we've got to have a correct opinion about who Jesus is. We've got to know the truth. That's one of the tests. One of these things we're going to be looking at is, have your beliefs changed? Do you believe what Jesus says about Jesus? It's not just about believing the right things in an abstract kind of way, but it's about actually knowing the God of the Bible, actually knowing the God who created the universe, and not some mental projection of who you would like God to be like, a God made out of your own image. The second test is it's a righteousness test. It's a life test. It's even a moral test. Are we keeping the commands of God? Sin is shown to be wholly incompatible with the nature of God as light, the mission of the Son to take away sins, and the new birth of the believer. And so what we see as a second test is, has your life changed? It's not, are you doing things that will please God? It's not, are you doing enough to earn salvation? This is not the test. The test isn't, do you stack up? Do you meet the mark? We can't meet the mark. We know that. That's why we rely wholly on grace and the mercy and the love of God. But when he has revealed his love to us, it necessarily changes what we love. It necessarily changes how we live. It changes even our affections. And the more we allow the Holy Spirit to do that refining work as we become more and more like Jesus, as we are transformed by the renewing of our mind, Paul says, as we come under and become more like Jesus, not only do our beliefs change, but our activity changes. Again, we're not preaching moralism. The goal is not to get you to behave better. The goal is not to say, this is how Christians live, this way, this way, this way, this way, and this way. And you go, okay, well, I have to be better at this, have to be better at that, have to be better at that, have to be better at that. No. It's about, have you experienced the love of God? Do you know what that means for you? Are you letting the Holy Spirit and the Word of God in Scripture inform your mind? Refine who you are so that you will naturally, and when I say natural, I don't mean like your proclivities will all of a sudden change, but over time, you'll become more and more like Jesus. You'll grow to love what God loves, think how God thinks, etc. Do we run from sin? Do we pursue holiness? Do we pursue the Holy Spirit's work in us? That's the second test. And the third test, and we're not just looking at this today. This is the broad headings for the next 13 weeks. Third test is relational. How do we love each other? Since God is love and all love comes from God, it's clear that a loveless person doesn't know God. John says those words in this letter. Have you received God's love? And in response, do you love him? And does that change the way that you love others? Like I said before, around 40 times in this one letter, 5 chapters long, John encourages us over and over and over again with the love of God, and that would reorient our affections towards him and reorient how we relate to each other, that we would actually love each other like God loves us. So there's 3 tests, how you believe, where you belong and how you belong in love, and who you are becoming more like. So that brings us to the beginning of the letter. So that's the intro for all of John. I just want to spend a small amount of time just in the opening remarks of this letter so that we can really get into it a little bit. But I realize that we haven't actually really prayed yet. So let's consider that the intro. Let's pray. We'll get stuck into the scripture and see what God might have for us tonight. Father God, again, we thank you for your word. We thank you for revealing yourself by your Holy Spirit through these authors, and today especially through your servant and friend John. Would you help us have open hearts and minds to your Holy Spirit's work tonight? In Jesus' holy name we ask, amen. All right, 1 John 1 says this, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life. I mean, thus far, he's a couple of verses in. We don't even really know what he's talking about yet. He's building to something. He says, which was with the Father and which was manifest to us, that which we have seen and heard and proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. He's writing these things so that our joy may be complete. He's started in a very interesting way. If you've read any other letters or books from the Bible, in the New Testament in particular, ordinarily they'll start like this. If it's from Paul, they'll say, Paul, an apostle of Christ, to the church in Ephesus, or to the church in Corinth, or something like that. John doesn't start that way. He starts in a very particular kind of way. He wants to draw his listeners or readers in. He wants you to, I was saying this morning in the morning service, it's kind of like, I actually think it's very, very much like a movie trailer where he says, so it's the beginning of like something, you know, there's a you get the fade in, there's a sunrise coming up over something, and in a world, or one man's journey, something, something, something. He's trying to bring people in. He's building upon it over and over and over and over and over again because he wants to build anticipation in the person and the work of who Jesus is. very similar to how he starts his gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And he goes on and on for 17 verses before he identifies that it's Jesus. He says, you know, all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And he's building people's interest. Who is this person that he's talking about? And it's the same here. And in fact, John's building his credibility here as well. Because these teachers, these false teachers, these thieves were coming into the church. And they're saying, no, 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 Jesus isn't like this. Jesus is like that. Jesus didn't raise from the dead bodily. You think you're going to raise from the dead bodily? No, 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 no. It's like this. The people were doubting their faith. They were doubting. They lost their assurance. They're doubting even though they knew who Jesus was. Some even left the church and went to start this new thing over here with this false Jesus. And John starts his letter by saying, I know Jesus. You're talking about Jesus? I've touched Jesus. You're telling me he didn't raise from the dead physically? I touched him. You're telling me you've got some novel ideas about what Jesus said? I heard him. I listened to him. I spoke with him. I ate with him. Saying, you can trust what I'm saying to you. Saying, I know Jesus. He says, this eternal life has been made manifest to us. What's been made manifest? Jesus. What does it mean? He's saying Jesus actually came and actually physically dwelt among us. That God, in perfection from eternity past, would stoop so low as to not just become in his creation, but to become a part of creation by taking on flesh. And then when Jesus rose from dead, he kept the flesh. Jesus is like us. He came for us. John is saying. Again, he's reminding us it's incredibly, incredibly important that we know who Jesus is. Not that just that we have some vague idea of this person who lived a couple of thousand years ago, or even that he is God in some ethereal kind of way, but that we know not just about him, but that we know him. It's one of the reasons that John is writing. So we have confidence in his saving work. He gives two so that's in this opening bit. So that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father. And then again, he says, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we're writing these things so that our joy may be complete. So the first reason, he says, this is why I'm writing. Here's the big deal. Here's the big idea. I'm writing this so that you would have fellowship with us. So that we'd be united in knowing who Jesus is. And this is, again, this is one of the reasons that we are so keen to get into Scripture and see what Scripture have for us, because that's the same thing that we want to say to each other. Would we have fellowship together? Would we be united in and around the person and the work of Jesus? John knows this kind of fellowship isn't born just out of having similar interests. It's not born out of just a similar background or a similar anything, but knowing God and having received his grace and his love. It's God's grace and his love that shape us as individuals and shape our community. If we want to have unity, we need to have unity around who Jesus is and what that means for us. This is why John is writing. Sometimes you may not feel like you have fellowship with people. Fellowship in a social circle, maybe based around maintaining a particular etiquette or a particular lifestyle, a particular level of income. And if you don't live up to those things, you might try for a little bit to volitionally or in your own strength make up for the deficit. In a workplace, certainly, fellowship or belonging in that workplace is contingent upon your ability to perform. And if you perform at a substandard level, your fellowship in that team or in that workplace won't last very long. You might, even in a church, you might have belonged to churches. I mean, again, hopefully not this one, but you might have belonged to Christian communities that required some level or projected level of holiness. That people wouldn't gather around the grace and the love of God, that we could live lives laid bare and share our struggles, share our deficiencies, share our weaknesses, because in our weakness, the gospel is made more glorious. God's glory is more seen in our own weakness rather than when we are just pulling ourselves up from our bootstraps and doing it all in our own strength. And you might have lacked fellowship, even in Christian community, by fearing people knowing who you really are. There's a word for this in particular in the marketplace called the imposter syndrome, where people, in fact, many, many people, even very successful people, have what they call an imposter syndrome, where even despite many accomplishments, they might not really know everything that they're doing, or they're looked up to because of past successes, and they feel the pressure of having to maintain a particular level of success and even finding their own identity wrapped up in that same success, that same performance, and they fear the day the failure comes because their identity and even their community is wrapped up in their ability to perform. Or even just, in a social circle. Man, there would be people even here, maybe everybody to some degree, although my hope and prayer is that the Holy Spirit would be refining this out of us. That we would, even though next week we'll look at, John says that God is light, and that we weren't just bad people who became better people, but we were dead people, we were darkness. And yet God has brought us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his Son in glorious light. Even to the point that Jesus says in Matthew 5, you are the light of the world. He says, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good deeds and give glory to your Father in heaven. And yet we withhold a little bit of who we are, because we fear if people knew this about me, they would reject me. If they knew my background, they knew my secrets, they knew what really went through my head, if they knew that I actually wasn't as good as the image of myself that I project to myself, if they realize I'm actually not as cool as everybody else in this circle. And the thing is, almost every other person in that community is thinking the exact same thing. And they live in fear. They feel like an imposter. Oh man, if someone just knew this thing about me, it's over. If they knew what I struggled with, again, if they knew what I had been through in my past, people would reject me. That is the antithesis of the gospel. That is how to avoid fellowship. But John here says, none of that. So in writing these things that you would have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father. Our fellowship is with Jesus. Our fellowship isn't based on our good deeds. Our fellowship certainly isn't based on how good an image can I put out there so that other people would love me, not realizing that they don't love you, they love the image you're putting out there. Would you just let somebody love you by letting them know who you are? This is one of the reasons that we're so big on discipleship groups, because lots of people don't have a best friend. Lots of people don't have people they can go to and actually say to them, in a Christian community, like applying and living out of the gospel in their lives, this is what I'm struggling with, and the other person not rejecting them and not saying, you're evil, but saying to them, I am a sinner too. That we gather together, we have unity around Jesus, who even though we were darkness, came for us, became like us. Philippians 2 says, emptied himself for us. We are doing the opposite of proclaiming the gospel when we try to make ourselves look better than we are. When we refuse to let people know who we are and let them love us. In Galatians, Paul's letter to the Galatians, he says, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. Meaning that if you don't have a burden to share, you are not only for yourself but for others in your community, not allowing the law of Christ to be fulfilled. You're not allowing the gospel to be at work in your life. Can we commit to, in the strength of the Holy Spirit, commit to rejecting that imposter syndrome? Because the reality is that if you are trying to project an image of yourself as better than you are, or that you don't struggle, or trying to hide really who you are and not bring those things into the light, you are an imposter. You are an imposter. But Christians are imposters. We don't see that in Scripture. We see in Scripture people saying, yeah, I'm a sinner. And you know what's beautiful is everybody in here, we all know that we're all sinners. We all know that our sin is what necessitated Jesus stepping down off the throne and becoming sin. That's why Jesus came. Was for our sin. To divert the wrath of God that was resting on us. There's no need for us to try to project some other image of who we want people to think that we are. No need for that. All your sins have been covered. All of your weaknesses have been dealt with. And the weakness that remains is there for your good and for your joy, so you can see God at work in your life. It's there for the glory of God, so that other people can see, oh, they're not just a rad person, they have Jesus. Is this making sense? Awesome. So that we would have, you would have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with God and with his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the kind of unity and fellowship that John is calling us to. I think it's actually it's a phenomenal and beautiful picture of what Christian community should be. That we'll be the most loving. You know how free you are to love people when you live those kind of lives laid bare? Because you're not in competition with anybody anymore. You don't have to try to make yourself look as good as other people. You don't have to worry when other people do great things and you feel like your time hasn't come yet and so you need to tear them down a little bit so that everybody's level. No. You can love even your enemies when you're living in light of the gospel, let alone your brothers and sisters in Christian community. It's beautiful. And John goes on, and we're writing these things so that our joy may be complete. Saying our joy. So I think he's really saying, or in Scripture he's saying, our joy as the messengers. So as you can read through this opening passage, he's saying, we have heard, we have seen, we have touched. And he's saying, our joy. So the messengers of the gospel of grace have joy in the proclamation of how amazing this grace is. And the hearers have amazing joy in how good the gospel of grace is. John's saying, man, it's for joy that we gather around Jesus. It's for joy that we want you to have sound doctrine. Again, it's not just some sort of stodgy checklist of, oh, do I believe these things? Yes, I do, yes, I do, yes, I do, great. I believe those things in some sort of abstract way. No. It's about, do you know Jesus? That your joy might be complete. That your joy might be full in the hearing, in the changing of your mind and your life, and in the proclamation of the gospel of grace. He's saying, believe in Jesus. Know him like we know him. Come into fellowship. Be in unity with us in the community of love. What joy that will bring to us both. That's what he's saying. And so for some of us here, you might have, again, known about Jesus for a long time. You might have known about him. Might have even hung around church for a long time, but never, ever really known him. That might be you. You might have enjoyed fellowship at one stage, but like John's readers, you've been led astray by foolish doctrine. by people that sound really good, or they have great music, or they have charismatic teachers, or that it sounds great and it makes my life easier, or promises me riches in this life now, and you've been led astray, or you've just become so acclimated or familiar with the gospel that it loses its impact in you or on you, that you were darkness. Not just in darkness, you were darkness, and now you are the light of the world. You might never have stepped foot in a Christian community before, and you might just be here visiting tonight. You're wondering what the heck is going on here. This guy's been talking for half an hour now. For you, for all of you, and for me, John says, believe and come into a relationship with God and with us. This is his starting point. This is his premise. Believe in Jesus. Know Jesus. Jesus gathered his disciples one time, and he asked this question, who do you say that I am? In fact, he asked Peter in particular. I think this is the single most important question in the world. Who do you say that Jesus is? There's no more important question than that. How do you answer that question? And then, can we test the outcome of our way of life and see whether we just say that or whether we actually believe it? Where do we have the proof of a changed life? These are the things we're going to be looking at over the next 13 or so weeks. It's going to be a great adventure. It's going to be incredibly helpful for, I think, everybody. And like I said before, if you're not in a discipleship group, that is where I think the real work happens, where we do get alongside each other. And again, like iron sharpens iron, we would participate in that Holy Spirit's work of refining each other, of identifying those sinful proclivities and things that need to be put to death in our lives. We would encourage each other in the love and assurance of the love of God the Father and the fellowship of Jesus. Let's pray together. Father God, we again thank you for your word. And we thank you for scripture, that you have revealed yourself more and more to us. In the reading and as your Holy Spirit does his work in our hearts and minds. Our prayer is that you would do a great work in us as individuals, and that you do a great work in us as your community here at City Light. We really want to have the truth. We believe you are the truth. And because you are the way and the truth and the life, and we know that nobody comes to the Father but through you, and so we want to and need to know Jesus, how he really is. And so would you help us in our reading, help us in our community, help us in our listening to know you as you really are. We love you. We thank you for your servant and friend, John. We pray that these next few months would be really helpful in us, again, as individuals, in our own joy in receiving the gospel and in our joy in proclaiming and heralding the great news that though we were your enemies, you have made us your friends. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. And for his sake, amen.